Success. Well, Danny, talk to me about the significance of what took place in Bolivia, because in the past, when there were U.S.-backed coups, basically, or the leader would either be assassinated or overthrown, and the whole system would be turned upside down. Tell me the significance that that didn't happen this time around.
Good morning to Tehran and the peace-loving people of the world. Put quite simply, Bolivia defeated U.S. imperialism. Everything was stacked against the different indigenous nations of Bolivia, stacked against the movement of socialism of Evo Morales and Luis Arce and so many other fighters for a true people's democracy. We had the Pentagon and the intelligence services of the U.S. working overtime to defeat this revolution, now 15 years in the making. Since Evo Morales first won the election in 2006, we had Luis Almagro and these other mouthpieces in Latin America, like the Organization of American States, doing everything to try to defeat the MAS, to try to discourage the masses of Bolivian people. But the masses came into the streets. They stood fearlessly, despite all of the fascist threats. We still have Bolivian ministers from Evo Morales's government who are still in the Mexican embassy in order to be safe. We still have the former president and people's leader, the symbolic leader of the entire Bolivian People's Revolution, Evo Morales, in exile in Argentina. So there's still a long way to go in terms of reparations for those who were under threat. The mayor who red paint was thrown all over her when the coup happened a year ago. So there's a long way to go, but certainly this massive electoral victory against these fascist elements backed by the U.S. military were significant. And Luis Arce got 55% of the vote, with 85% of the Bolivian electorate participating.
Well, Danny, what about the election itself? Were you surprised that there wasn't an attempt to basically not let this, again, transition of power take place, basically cheating at the polls or trying to control? Were you surprised, basically, that the current government accepted it, although, as you have said, 88% of the people showing up definitely is not an easy task.
I think many of us in progressive circles were actually surprised, but it's way too early to say that this victory is solidified, because political power is not synonymous with economic power. We know that in Santa Cruz and in other fascist strongholds, that's not to say that all of Santa Cruz is fascist. Of course, there's many working class and indigenous people there who represent the MAS despite whatever threats. But that was the area, Santa Cruz, that came to symbolize this European descendant, racist, fascist elements. And we're sure that they have many tricks up their sleeves. They've talked about secession in the past. They've certainly done everything to corner the gas markets, the lithium markets. We remember the water wars that predated the MAS's ascent to power. So it's too early to say that the entire revolution is consolidated, but certainly these are very, very good signs that were difficult to expect a week ago. A week ago, many of us were very fearful that there would be bloodshed. But there's still all types of right-wing rumors. They're saying that 35 of Áñez's ministers are going to try to go into exile in the United States because they're fearful of whatever retaliation from the MAS. So the rumor mill is in full swing. And we don't expect these fascist elements with their U.S. backing just to go away. And of course, we have to look at the international implications of this victory as well. What does this mean for Venezuela? What does this mean for Nicaragua? What does this mean for Cuba? What does it mean for Chile, which tomorrow has an important constitutional plebiscite? What does it mean for Latin America and the poor people of the world?
Thank you so much for being with us, Danny Shaw, professor of Latin American and Caribbean Studies out of.